What happens on the mountain can't stay on the mountain. What happens here has to get there. And God's delivery system is called faith. A little bit of faith. A little bit of faith. There are some things in our lives and in our community and in our city that by the power of the word of God and by the power of our worship are about to move from here to there. Do you believe it? Do you believe it? In fact, I feel like I want to set an atmosphere and we want to see some things move tonight in the presence of God. Come on, how many of you are ready to make a move? We're moving. We're moving. We're moving. We're moving from death to life. We're moving from darkness to light. We're moving from defeat to victory tonight. Somebody's crossing over from shame to grace tonight. Somebody's moving from fear to faith tonight. Jump up on your feet. Somebody's moving from sorrow to joy tonight. He's here. Lift your hands. He's here. We can't stay here. We gotta go. We gotta go. We got a charge to keep. We got a God to serve. We got a gospel to preach. We got broken hearts to bind. We've got hurting people to heal. Come on, move, church. Move. We're not waiting on a move of God. We are a move of God. Come on and shout.
Come on, lift up your voices and give God some praise. Somebody lift up your voices. This is the hour, this is the moment. Without any further ado, I tell you what, the energy in this house, the presence of God is here, ready for the word of God. No further delay. Would you help me make welcome my brother, Greg McGregor, the evangelist. Come and minister the word of God. Come on, give God some praise.
We're going to try it again. Thank you for the patty cake. Let us give the Lord a praise in this house. I wonder if the ushers can open the doors quickly. Just push the door open right where you are, brother. And we're going to shout Jesus and they're going to take off. I don't believe they're here. They're gone already, you know, but we just want to make sure they're really gone. Let us shout Jesus. I think they almost heard that. One more time. Jesus! Woo! I'll tell you, this place is on fire. Amen. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Dance group, you did awesome. I'm going to give you a little break, just a little breather. I see I've got an English major that's going to read for us. And if you're ready for the Word of God, I want you to take your Bible in your hand. Just the Bible. No notebooks. I cannot see the Bibles. Bring your Bible to church. That's right. I've got a big sword. I see some of you have a little pocket knife. Say, I believe.
I believe.
We can say it better than Texas. Come on. I believe.
I believe.
This is the true Word of God. I will not add anything. And I won't take anything away from it. And I believe this is the holy, written, spoken, inspired Word of God. And I, Greg, say your own name. I, Greg, want to go to God's heaven. And I will never, let's mean it, I will never, ever be the same again. In Jesus' name. Amen. Are you ready for the Word of God tonight? All the singing and the worship, everything was awesome, but you know, there's nothing like the Word of God. Hallelujah. We need the Word of God. It's bread. It is life. Amen. Bless the Lord. If you have your Bibles with you, I want us to go tonight to the book of John. Big John. And I'm going to ask my baby girl to come read. I'm just excited that all the young people are so on fire for God. Amen. Don't you think there's just a glow around them? They're so on fire for God. And we got to keep the hands up and pray for them, that God will just keep them going. Amen. And give them more passion, that they will just get deeper, deeper, and deeper, and deeper. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord.
I'm just going to read from the screens. So if you're not in the same translation, feel free to take a look up. John 4:4, but he needed to go through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar. That's my best. Someone can correct me later. Near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour.
That just got me excited there. Jesus being tired. Did you get excited about that? That Jesus can get tired. The one that spoke the heaven and the earth into existence got tired.
That's good.
Does that bless you? He went to sit on the rock that he spoke into existence, that built the well. The same Jesus that opened the blind eyes, the same Jesus that made the cripple to walk, the same Jesus that walked on the water got tired. I believe God just wants to show us tonight that Jesus, being God, was also fully man. I just got excited right there. I don't know about you. I thought of just running this place here when she said Jesus was weary and he was tired. I guess you know what the message is tonight. A new perspective. I want you tonight to look at everything that you look at it at a new and fresh perspective. Because a lot of times when we look at something, the first thing we say, well, the glass is half empty. If you listen to the news and watch television, you find they say there is a 20% chance of rain. There's a 5% chance of rain. What about the 80%? What about the 90%? Have a fresh and new perspective tonight. Continue, Yolandi.
A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans."
Huh. They have no dealings with the Samaritans. If you have no dealing with someone, you probably don't like that person. You don't want to be around them. Now, as I study the Word of God and as you go into history, you'll find out that the Jewish people and the Samaritan people, they did not like one another. They basically despised one another. If the Jews had to go down to Jerusalem and the map said go through Samaria, or Google said go through Samaria, if you put it on your GPS, they would take the long route just to miss Samaria. They didn't like them at all. Just imagine if Raymond was Jewish, and he's Jewish now because he's saved, he's born again. Amen. And somebody brought a beautiful chocolate cake that he loves. That's his favorite. And Raymond, being Jewish, heard that a Samaritan baked that cake. He will spit it out. He won't eat it. That is how bad it was. We can continue with the story. I just want you to get the picture.
Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it was who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water."
Woo.
The woman said to him, "Sir..."
I want somebody just to say living water. Say it like it's living water.
Living water.
You saying like it's old salt water or dry water, just saying like it's living water.
Living water.
Continue, Yolandi.
The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give them will never thirst. But the water that I shall give them will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life."
Read verse 17, Yolandi. Read verse 17. If you have a 17 on there.
The woman answered and said, "I have no husband."
Huh. Not one, not two, not three. Not four, not five. Thank you for helping me. I just forgot the number after four, right? She had five husbands, and the one that she has now, she's just living with him. She must have been so downtrodden. Of all the rejection, because in those days what happened, the woman had no so-say in the marriage. If the husband wanted to give her the pass to go, he had the right. So she was so full of rejection, five husbands rejecting her, and she might have been on the verge of being rejected again. Go ahead, Yolandi.
The woman answered him, "I have no husband." One back, thank you. Jesus said to her, "You have well said, 'I have no husband.'" The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet."
Now I perceive you're a prophet. First she said, "What do you have to do with me? What do you have to do with us? I'm a Samaritan. You don't have a bucket for water and it's deep. How are you going to get the water out of there?" And now she says, "I perceive you are a prophet." She changed her perspective from looking at Jesus being a Jew, and now she says, "I perceive you are a prophet." That's a little bit of a change of heart right there. And I believe tonight each and every one of us here tonight needs a change of heart. This is not in my notes, but there was a little story about this farmer that had a little piggy. Now, those little potbelly piggies are really beautiful and they're so cute, aren't they? And this farmer just loved this little piggy and walked this little pig on it. And he even made a gold chain for this little piggy and he walked the piggy. And then he got a nice suit for the pig, pink suit. A pink pig in a pink suit. So he's walking the piggy in the pink suit and the gold chain. And one Sunday, it was a beautiful Sunday, he took the piggy on a walk and there was a puddle of water because it was raining. I think it was somewhere here in Tennessee. And as he's walking this little piggy, the piggy saw the mud puddle and went straight in there and dove into the mud puddle. And the farmer said, oh no. He sent the suit to the cleaners and had the jeweler clean the little chain. And left it for a couple of weeks, and he took the little piggy out again. It rained again, it was in Tennessee somewhere. Expect rain anytime, right? Just hang around and the weather will change. He took the little piggy on a stroll again and walked, and he was looking away because there was some distraction there, and the piggy saw that mud puddle, and he went straight in the mud puddle. He was so upset. This is a rich farmer. He went to his doctor. He said, doctor, I love my little piggy, but every time I pass a mud puddle, he goes straight into the mud puddle. And then I have to go clean the chain. I've got to go clean all his new little pink suit that he has. And what can we do about it? And the doctor said, sir, I think I have a plan. Bring him in and we'll have a surgery. It was a week later. They scheduled the surgery and the little piggy went in. And at the back, they heard the little lamb. And then there was no more lamb sound back there. And they came in and transplanted a lamb heart into this little piggy. And a few weeks later, he was up and running again. And piggy is all fine with this new lamb heart he had. And it rained again and the farmer said, I'm going to test drive this again. So he took the little piggy out and went right in front of the puddle, trying, you know, entice the little pig to go in the mud puddle. And the little piggy jumped over the mud puddle and the little hind leg got in the mud and he started shaking it off. He had a change of heart. Give the Lord a praise. Say, somebody needs a change of heart. Somebody needs a fresh perspective. This lady came to Jesus. Well, what I like about Jesus, he was telling his disciples, I need to go through Samaria. And the disciples probably threw a fit. Jesus, did you say Samaria? You know how we feel about Samaria. And you said Samaria? Jesus said, in the King James, I must needs go through Samaria. And he said, well, if he said so, we'll go. And we see that when Jesus came to the well, sitting there on the rock that he created, being tired, just waiting. And tonight I want to tell you, Jesus is not in a hurry. He'll wait for you. He'll wait for you. Because I believe that a miracle can happen anytime. That lady that had five husbands and now living with someone came to the well that day during high noon. There was no one. She was in shame. She was disappointed in life because things did not work out. Five husbands. And some of you are still looking for one. And as she's standing there drawing her water, she didn't know Jesus was going to be there. So she probably pulled her little veil down, you know, not wanting to be seen because of all the shame and things that went into her life. And probably the people in town were speaking about her. And she probably thought that Jesus knew about her too. And Jesus struck up a conversation. Remember, she perceived he was a prophet, but before she knew that, Jesus knew her. And just as Jesus knew her, He knows each and every person here tonight. And we walking around with that deep hurt and past rejection and pain and sorrow, and maybe life hasn't treated us that well, and sickness and whatever might be wrong in your life and our past that is dark. But here Jesus is sitting and waiting. And just at the right moment, as she was there in the shame, bringing up the water, wanting to drink of that water, and she thought it was good water. And then this man is asking a Jewish man, ma'am, woman. Not in an ugly way, I believe Jesus would have said, lady, woman, but that's the translation, in a nice tone. Will you give me some water? And straight away her guard was up. What have we to do with one another? You're a Jew, I'm a Samaritan. But Jesus, wiser than a Solomon, knew how to make a conversation. Amen. No Dr. Phil, no Oprah could talk that lady into a miracle. Jesus, the great communicator, spoke into her life and said, woman, if you just knew who was asking you for water. And tonight in your problem, in your situation where you are, Jesus is saying to each and every person here tonight that has a deep, deep, dark past and problem and rejection and whatever might be in your life. He's saying, if you just knew who is asking you for water, you would have asked him. And when Jesus told her, go get your husband, she said, truly, I don't have a husband. That was the truth. And Jesus said, yes, you had five. And the one you have now, you're just living with. I'll tell you, you can expect a miracle anytime if you're in the right place. And you know what? You're in the right place here tonight for your miracle. You sat at home and something stirred you up. You got to go get some water. And you thought you were just going to come get a nice song and a nice sermon and just a nice drink here tonight. But I want to tell you, the one that will give the living waters here tonight, that will fill you up, that will fill you up. It will fill up from the inside and will be like rivers flowing through you. And tonight Jesus wants to give you that living water that will last, and you will not thirst again if you have this living water. What are you talking about, Brother Greg? This woman ran and she went to spread the news of this godly man. And you might be in Samaria tonight. You might be in a place where nobody knows what happened to you, or nobody cares. But I want to tell you, Jesus goes to where nobody else wants to go. And tonight, Jesus is not in a hurry. He will sit and wait for you until you make the move. I believe that a miracle can happen tonight because God, you see, God is motion driven. Draw nigh unto me and I will draw unto you. I tried it last night there. They've got a little trash can back there in that room back there. And I tried to open the thing and I kicked it and bumped it. And when I was waving my hand over it, the lid started opening up. And I said, praise God, a miracle just happened right now. And the other day I was at the bank and I tried the same thing. I saw people inside and it was all locked. And I went to the door and stood there and nothing happened. I went a little closer and nothing happened. And then when I did that, the doors opened up. Another miracle! Just before the service tonight, I went into the bathroom. I looked at that little thing hanging on the wall, and I wanted to dry my hands. And I said, there's no towels around here. And I remembered I did that. An abundance of towel came out. It just came out. It just came out. Another miracle happened. If you draw nigh unto God, He will draw near unto you. If you start worshiping and waving your hands here tonight, whew, what does He say? He will come live among us if we do that. If you start motioning, if you start moving, works, let me say, is what? Faith without works. So what do you have to move? If you want your miracle, you have to move. Did somebody get that picture? Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor. Look at your neighbor. Tell your neighbor you have to have a fresh perspective. Okay, if that neighbor's a little stuck up, look to the other neighbor. Now tell the other neighbor, you really need a fresh perspective. Praise the Lord. We all need a fresh perspective. You talking about a fresh perspective? Jesus being the Garden of Gethsemane. In Mark 14, chapter 14 and verse 32 through verse 36. Jesus went out to pray and left the disciples. And he told them, his heart is really heavy. Then he went to pray and he asked God, his Father, let this cup pass from me. If you don't think Jesus knows your hurts and your pains and your suffering and where you've been, He's gone through that. He was a man of sorrow. Jesus knows your hurts. Jesus knows your pain. Jesus knows your situation. He knows all about it. Your rejection, He knows about it. He asked the Father, he said, Father, let this cup pass by, but not my will, but your will done. A new perspective he got right there because he knew that the Father will do it. And tonight he will do it in your life. If you have a new perspective coming to him, not saying like the Israelites said, I wonder if God can do it. Not, I wonder if God can do it. God can do it. Because His promises are yes and amen. Let's look at someone else that also had a hard time. Yolanda, do you want to come read this? She's such an affluent reader. If I had an Afrikaans Bible, it would be better. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and we're going to read verse 7 and 8 and also verse 17.
But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory.
Woo! Hallelujah! Bless the Lord. That just gave me some Holy Ghost goosebumps on that one there. You might be pressed on every side. You might be persecuted. You might be knocked down, but not knocked out. The Apostle Paul knows about that. He's been beaten. He's been shipwrecked. He's been stoned. Not the Colorado stoning. I'm talking about a different stoning. He's been on the island of Malta where preacher was preaching on the other night, where he took that snake. Where's that snake? Where he took that snake and shook it off when that viper latched on him. And they were waiting for his demise. Whew! But he had a new perspective. Even being in the ship, he told the guys, don't jump. Don't bail the ship, because we're all going to live. What a positive perspective from this man. It did not matter where he is or what he did. His only mission was to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it didn't matter how long or where it's going to take him. He went right there. Out of the backside of the jail, he wrote to the church. He encouraged Timothy. He said, don't give up. He was on a mission with a new perspective when he was knocked off that horse. He thought he was going to persecute God's people. But when God speaks to you and get to you with a 2x4 on the side of your head, you get a new perspective. Some of us just need it a little bit harder, right? The same with kids. Some of the kids just take it easy. They listen. Others, you really got to put them in the corner and ground them for 2 weeks. The Apostle Paul. They said he went to a church and applied to be the pastor. And when they saw his resume, I said, we don't want that man here. They didn't know it was from him, but at the bottom, it was signed the Apostle Paul. A rebel for the right cause. A rebel for Jesus Christ. Having a new perspective for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And tonight, just like that woman with the issue of blood that one of the preachers were talking about, and this woman coming to Jesus, you can have a new perspective wherever you are. You don't have to go lay down. You don't have to die. You don't have to walk around with that shame and with the guilt and walk around with that pain and hurt of the past. Tonight, Jesus, the Messiah, Lamb of God. You talking about shame and being shamed? Try walking on the Villa Dolorosa. The path of shame. Jesus took it upon him, going to the heel of Golgotha, going to the heel of the skull. He walked the walk already. You don't have to walk there. You don't have to go through all the stuff that you're going through, because Jesus was mocked. He was shamed. His beard was pulled out of his face. But still he walked that walk because he had you and me on his mind. And tonight in closing, I want to come back to that woman. She expected to put this man on his place. Like many of us, we get defensive when the preaching goes out and it touches you and you say, well, I'm not coming back to that church again because I've been offended. But the Bible says we need to meditate on these things. Can somebody tell me the scripture? You're going to get a hat. Philippians 4:8. Whatever. Some translations will say whatsoever, but I like to say whatever, like the young people. Whatever. Whatever things are good, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are pure. meditate on these things. Don't meditate on those other things. Meditate on these things. Amen. And you will have a new, fresh perspective. May the Lord bless you tonight as you will stand on your feet and as the worship team. Lord, we bless you. We thank you for this wonderful evening that you have ordained. And thank you for visiting us here tonight. I believe tonight, friend, long before you were here, while prayers were going on in this church, Jesus was waiting here for you. He was waiting here for you, sitting here already, waiting for you to come in. And you just came at the right time for your miracle, for your touch. He is right here. I want to ask my brothers, as the worship team will sing, to just stand here, and I want you to, we don't want to fill the altars. If you don't want a new perspective, please sit down. But if you want a new perspective in life, I want you to come tonight and be touched by the Master himself. Because when you came in here tonight, he was waiting here for you already, and he's asking you, will you give me some water? What is your question? What is your answer? Will you make your way to the front tonight and come drink of this water, that you won't thirst again? Water of healing. Water of peace, of prosperity, of joy, to liberate you. Thank you, Jesus. There's a few hungry people here tonight. I'm the first one out here in the altars. I need it. I need a fresh perspective. There's nothing but the blood of Jesus. Go ahead, will you sing?
Message from the Lord. As your vision from where you're looking at been blurred, been obscured by the things that you have gone through. For this woman, it was five husbands, rejection, ostracized. She had to come at an inconvenient hour just to get some water. Have you had to dodge people, get away from some because how they've been treating you or looking at you, the things they've said about you, and now it has blinded you from seeing God's goodness, from knowing who it is that's here? And so the preacher said, today God is going to give us a new perspective, a new way of looking, a new way of seeing. See, if I have somebody standing, I was thinking about that, Brother Greg, powerful word. But if he's over here and I'm trying to see in my way in front and he's blocking my vision, I can't see. I will stumble and all of the things. It's hard to move forward in life, right? But if I just come around, oh my goodness, look all that I can see. It is a new perspective. And so for many of us, we've walked all our lives not seeing. But God says, come on, I'm going to let you look another way, in a new direction. Look fresh again. See me for who I am. If you knew who it was that says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him. So today, he's extending that hand, that invitation again. Come on. on. Is there someone else? We have our young people. I'm so proud of our guys. They are here. They said, God, I need a new perspective. I need a new perspective. You say, well, my life is over. No, sir, it's not over. There's some, look at the kids. They say, I need a new perspective. They haven't even really started in life. But how many know if God could give them a fresh vision for their lives right now, can you imagine the heartache they can avoid? They don't have to go through like you and I have. But see, even for you and I, we can still get a new perspective. If that's you, come. Always be willing to say, Lord, here I am. I want to see like you see. In the name of Jesus, press in a little closer. If you can, press in a little closer. Come a little deeper right now. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, precious is that flow. Makes me white. Washes the old. Give me new. Out of new vision. Together, if you will. There's some spaces here that can be filled. Greg, you said a minute ago, if you don't need her, it's not for everybody. We know that. So I don't need a fresh perspective. Well, then that's okay. That's no condemnation here.
You know, Pastor, if I stood at the bank and I saw people in there and I didn't make a move, I wouldn't have gone inside the bank. I could go draw money and get some money for gas. But if I didn't make a move, I said God is activated when you move. Come on. If you stay stagnant where you are, come on, you're not going to see a move of God. If you're going to stay where you are, and I'm not trying to get you in the altars, I'm just giving you. I went to Pensacola, my brothers were going to be down there. And something just drove into Birmingham, and something just pressed me to get off the interstate. And I don't know why. I said, I've got some snacks here. I had some grapes. I had some peanuts. I didn't have peanuts. I had, you know, just nice snacks Marie packed when I was driving just to keep me awake. And I obeyed that voice, and I made a move. I made a move. Somebody do that. Say, make a move. You saw these young people tonight make a move. And I made a move. I went off and I went in the garage or the gas station there. I walked around. I said, I don't need anything because I just put gasoline in a couple of miles up the road. What is this pressing that I should? And I walked around and I saw some of that hot peanuts. And I took that with me and got in the car and took off. And 5 minutes later, there was a big crash. That the one car went over the medium into that barrier that was in the wall. And I believe up till today that it was the Holy Spirit that made me go. And I was spared that big, it was probably an 8 or 10 car pileup that was there, just a big mess that happened there. This is how God can give you a miracle just like that. And if you make a move tonight, just make a move. Just decide right where you are now, I'm making a move. Come to the front and you will see he will draw nigh unto you. Let us just raise our hands and we're going to pray. If there's one more coming in, come quickly. Come quickly. If there's one more. There's somebody there needs a miracle. I want you to just make your way to the front. This lady said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I know I will be made whole. You know what she did? She had to reach out and touch. She had to make a move. Father, I come tonight And I pray, Lord, that you will give us a new perspective in this church and see the mighty and great things, that there will be no obstruction, no skew of our vision, but that you will let the scales fall off our eyes and see your glorious greatness, that we will not look at the big problem, but that we will look at the big God, that our God is bigger than our problem. And tonight, each and every person here tonight that needs a miracle in their lives, I pray, Lord, that you will come down and touch them just like you touched that woman at the well, just like you touched Paul, that was Saul, and just like you touched that woman with the issue of blood, just like you touched the blind man, just like you spoke into the life when Lazarus came running out. I ask now in the name of Jesus that each and every person here tonight that needs a touch and a miracle in their lives, that you will come down and touch them. Receive it right now in the name of Jesus. And as these men of God will lay hands on you, the Bible says, lay hands on them and they shall recover. We shall lay hands on them and they shall recover. Go ahead, sing.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.